tonight. I want to, a little lesson tonight that we want to kind of deal with. You know, isn't it strange how that we as God's people, the Lord tells us to forgive one another as he has forgiven us. And we all know that he had a lot to do, a lot to forgive us of, didn't he? He tells us to forgive one another the same way that he forgive us. Amen. And you know, when you are in the Lord, when he forgives you, he wipes it out. I'm not saying he wipes it out of his memory, but he don't bring it back up again to work against you. Other words, when he forgives you, it's already settled. He don't bring it back up. But how many of y'all know that, listen, some of you all sitting up in here, you can remember some things that people have did to you 15 or 20 years ago. Some of the things that went on in your hometown, don't you? And some of the things that went on in your neighborhood. And for some reason, every time you see, go through that neighborhood, you think about some of the things. And not only think about some of the things, it brings some of the people back in here, what they did. I guess what I'm saying, I want to talk tonight, I want to look at the sixth chapter of the gospel according to Mark chapter number six. Mark chapter number six. I'll go there, and then I'm going to let you know what we're going to discuss tonight. Sixth chapter of Mark, beginning at verse number one through six. I want to read those verses, and then we're going to all have something to say about it. See if you can remember. This make any sense to you? Mark chapter number 6, begin at verse number 1. Do everyone have it? It reads like this. And he went out from thence and came into his own country. And his disciples followed him. And when the Sabbath day was come, he began to teach in the synagogue. And many hearing him were astonished, saying, from whence has this man these things? And what wisdom is this which is given unto him, that even such mighty works are what? By his hand. Verse number 3 said, is not this the carpenter, the son of Mary, the brother of James and Joseph and of Judah and Simon? And are not this his sister here with us? And they were offended. But Jesus said unto them, a prophet is not without honor, but in his own country and among his own kin, and in his own house. And he could there do no mighty work, save that he laid his hand upon a few sick folks and healed them. And he marveled because of their unbelief, and he went round about in the village teaching. I want to just talk about and discuss hometown memories. Hometown memory. All right? Y'all let that sink in a little bit. Hometown memory. there are some things, some memories that it's hard for us to get rid of. Some people have did some things and that we just can't get rid of. We remember it, might have been 15, 20 years, but that we still remember that. And do you not know, as a result, if we are dealing with hometown memory, we are dealing with hometown memory. Other words, when the Lord forgive oppression, God rested on it. It's all over. But now he asks us to forgive man as he have forgiven us. But for some reason, we are still hanging on to hometown memory. And because you hold on to hometown memory, listen, you are really not free to worship God and be in a position that God might get the glory out of your life. Because now if you're holding on to hometown memory, it affects you. Not only the person that you still thinking about, but it affects you. Amen? I'm going to show you here's the text here. Mark chapter 6, verse 1 through 6, y'all. One that just came in, you might want to run there real quick. Hometown memory. Now, sometimes they are good. There are some hometown memories that they are good to, you know. I mean, you know, I remember some, you know, that when we was at home, nine kids, mom and daddy, and daddy wasn't making a whole lot of money. We didn't have a whole lot of meat, you know, but well, I could hear mama saying that, don't worry about it, God is able. And some way or somehow, she'd get up on the next morning cooking, and you smell the kitchen get the stinking. It looked like she had all kind of meat and stuff in the kitchen. And she just warmed up and saved that one piece of meat and put some bread on, some flour. And y'all, you know how you make that bread. And stuck that piece of meat in there, and now we're eating again. So there's some memories that are good that just hang on to it. But then there are some that are bad. You hear me? Because there are some memories that we hold on to, it affects us at moving forward. Because we holding on to a memory that we should have been turning loose, been turning loose. Yeah. We holding on to them. So Jesus ran into this problem here when he went back to Nazareth, to his own country. He had a problem when he went back there. Listen, some hometown, some memories help. Some of them are helpful. Hometown memory. Mm-hmm. And some of them are helpful. Then sometimes they hinder. Sometimes they are joyful. Sometimes they hurt. Sometimes they are good to share. But sometimes they are not. Sometimes they are not. Some things are good to share.
Yeah.
You might know it yourself. And don't nobody else know. That went on in your hometown. You are familiar with it, but don't nobody ever know anything about it. Then, but when you start trying to hold on to hometown memory, and then you want to share hometown memory with other people to bring them up to what went on in your hometown. See, that right there, it's not good. But there are some hometown memories that you can hold on to when you think about the goodness of God and the thing that God has brought you through and brought you the way he has brought you from. There is nothing wrong with that. That's a memory that you ought to hold on to and share it with your children and whoever else. But then that was something that we just need to turn loose. We cannot go forth holding on to some stuff. And do you not know that there's some stuff in it? It's not even much worth holding on to. It's kind of like when your telephone rang. Then your telephone rang. It said no. What the heck? No number. What the heck? Unknown. Yeah, your telephone. Like The rains are unknown. Kind of like a letter that come to you and don't have no name on it. And why you want to open it? You understand what I'm saying? Why you want to answer a phone when it says unknown? You know as crazy this stuff is right now. So hometown memory, listen, they hinder us from going forward. Now let's look at what the text said. Listen, and Mark chapter number 4, watch this now, verses 35 and 41, you ain't got to go there and read it, but you just write it down if you will. Jesus calmed the storm and said, peace be still. Now, that's something that his disciples, they remember that. They was there. Some of them witnessed him calming the storm. Not only that, but in Mark 5, 8 through 9, in this country of the Gadarenes, he cast out demons. In Mark chapter number 5, verses 25 through 36, he healed a woman with an issue of blood. Verse number 39 through 40, he healed Jairus' daughter. But, now these are the things that he did while he was not in his own hometown. He was not in Nazareth. Other words, he was somewhere else. And he was able to heal all of those, do all the work, all of those miracles. All of those miracles, he was able to do it. You know? And you know, sometimes when you are, when you go somewhere where folks, where you don't know people, those people will accept what you have to say a lot of time more than your hometown people will. Because hometown folks, they painted you as bad. And you done already got you done repented and God done wash you up and clean you up, but they still see you as a bad person. Okay? So what Jesus did, Jesus worked all of those miracles, and then the Bible said right here in verse number some warm. Listen to what it said. And when he came out from them and came into his own country, and his disciples, they followed him. And when the Sabbath day was come, he began to teach in the synagogue, and many hearing him were astonished. They were astonished. They heard him teach, and they heard him explain and unravel the scripture, and these people were excited. Those disciples, they were excited there. They said, listen now, we never seen anything like this right here. Okay? He's doing some things that we never witnessed before. And they were excited about that when he began to teach them and began to unravel the scripture. They were astonished by saying, they were astonished about it and so much so, listen, from whence have this man these things, and what wisdom is this which is given unto him? They were excited by the teaching, and then they were excited about the wisdom that the Lord Jesus had. Now, y'all stay with me. They were excited about his teaching. They looked at his wisdom, and then they wondered, how is it, or where did this man get this type of wisdom, this type of teaching? We never heard this type of teaching. Remember now, he's at home. Now, when he was away from home, he worked all kind of miracles. When he was away from home, when he taught the word of God, then people accepted what he taught them, and they were changed, and they were helped along the way. The Bible says that the God's people are destroyed for a lack of what?
Knowledge.
Now, knowledge can be all around you, but if you don't accept it, it don't mean anything. If you want to settle knowledge, do you not know knowledge is powerful? Knowledge is powerful. They said, now listen, this wisdom is this which is given unto him, that even such mighty works is worked by his hand. Look what happened now. They bragged about his teaching, didn't they? They bragged about his wisdom, didn't they? And they bragged about his mighty works. Did it? It's right there. What they they saw the works that they saw. They bragged about that. I'm going somewhere. Y'all stay with me. They bragged about it. They were astonished about his teaching. They were excited about the wisdom that he had. Then they looked at his mighty work. They remembered the works that he had done, you know, and they heard about the works. No doubt he had did some mighty works around them. Then they asked the question, is not this the carpenter, the son of Mary, the brother of Joseph, and of James, and Josiah, and of Judah, and Simon, and are not his sister here with us? And they were what? Offended. Now watch this right here. When they recognized who he was, they bragged about now his wisdom. They bragged about his teaching. You understand what I'm saying? They bragged about his mighty word. But then when they remember, hey, he come to them. Is not this the carpenter's son? We know him. We know his sisters and his brother. And and listen, at that point right there, that really blocked their avenue of knowledge. It blocked it because they said, now listen, we remember playing ball with you. We remember shooting marbles with you. We remember working with you doing carpenter work. And here you are. All of this teaching, all of this wisdom in them, the mighty works that you have worked, now they become offended at him because of the thing that God had blessed him to do. But it was all because, listen, they remember. Now, if they had never remembered anything about him, they never would have been offended. And sometimes we as people, we will allow our memory to go back home. And when we start thinking about what has happened, then we become offended at people. Y'all hear what I'm saying? No doubt there's someone sitting up in here right now. If the truth is told, you might be still offended at someone that maybe they didn't do you wrong, but maybe they did some of your folks wrong. Maybe they have something that you think they shouldn't have. You understand what I'm saying? A lot of times we as people, now it's a perfect example right here. When they found out about Jesus, then they were offended at him because of the thing that he was able to do. And hometown memory, sometimes you just need to forget about what you know and just go forward. Because sometimes what you know, it won't do anything but hold you back. They were impressed, they were astonished, but listen, didn't accept him as Jesus the Christ. They wanted to, they never did call him, they called, ain't you the carpenter's son? Ain't you Joseph's son? Even much in Matthew and in Luke, he was called Joseph's son, the son of the carpenter. They did not want to accept him as the Christ. Now, and thing about it is this right here. The thing that he was doing, couldn't nobody do it but the Christ. And they didn't want anybody to accept him as the Christ. And that's something that the Lord is doing for us. And we don't accept it. A lot of us still holler about it, you know, what we did. The people of Nazareth did not refer to Jesus as by name, but only as this man, a sign of contempt. When they said they didn't call him by name, they called him by this man. That was a sign of contempt. People, listen. Forget about hometown memory. Verse number 3. Listen to what it said. Is not this the carpenter, the son of Mary, the brother of James, Joseph, and of Judah, and Simon, and not this his sister here with us? And they were, the Bible said they were, offended. Watch this here. Is the only place in the Bible, verse number 3, is the only place in the Bible where Jesus is called a carpenter. Talked about it in Matthew 13, 55, Luke 4 and 32. But now, if you look at verse number 4, this is what verse number 4 said. But Jesus said unto them, now, after they were offended by him, after they was excited about his position, his mighty words, then he said to them, Jesus said unto them, a prophet is not without honor, but in his own country and among his own kin and in his own house. Now, because some of us, we feel like, my child, I can teach him and try to teach him all his life. And then he'll go down to Mr. Bobo's house. And Mr. Bobo will tell him to do something. And he'll jump on the bandwagon. Yeah. Right. And he'll do what Mr. Bobo did. This thing has just got started. People will listen. And they have a tendency to listen to other folk quicker than they will their own people. And this thing is not new. And one of the reasons why is that, listen, these folks, they were offended at Jesus, the thing that Jesus was able to do, because they remembered him as a carpenter's son. They remembered playing ball with him. They remembered that, listen, they walked with him, they talked with him, all of these things. But now here he is being their teacher, working miracles for them. And now they are offended at the master. And people listen. That right there, sometimes, as people, we are offended at folks when some kind of way the Lord elevate them a little bit above us. Sometimes we are offended at people. But now, he said this, and a prophet, not just lay people, but he talked about a prophet. Other words, a preacher, a prophet, have less honor in his own house than he do identity. I didn't have no problem when I was going around healing folks and teaching people. But when I finally got back home to Nazareth, in my own country, my own territory, that's when I met up with you guys, and then you became offended with me. In your own house. Listen, sometimes it ain't enough to fight about. It ain't bad enough to get rid of people's holes. But sometimes you the last person to find out what's going on in your own house. I know. Sometimes you want to be for yourself. You know I'm saying the truth. You know, and then you have the audacity to say, well, that's what John said. That's what Mary said. Well, what do I say? Listen to what it said in verse number 5. This is what I've been really trying to get. And he could there do no mighty work, except that he laid his hand up on a few sick folks and healed them. Now, the Bible said that he could not do any what? Right there in scripture. Mighty works, right? Except the only thing he did was lay his hand on a few sick folks and heal broken bones and revive people. But then it said he couldn't do no mighty works. But he was able to to heal. Y'all going somewhere now. Y'all ain't keeping up with me. Because if you're going, somebody's all along. Amen. You understand what I'm saying? He healed some broken bones, but he couldn't do no mighty work. He gave sight to the blind, but he couldn't do no mighty work. Y'all hear what I'm saying? He caused a lame man to walk, but he couldn't do no mighty work. So, you know, most of us, we consider that when my arm is broke and the Lord healed my broken arm, we consider it mighty work. But Jesus does not consider that to be mighty work. There are some works mightier than healing your body. Y'all hear what I'm saying? Only thing you're concerned about is what about your physical man. But Jesus said, now listen, I really want to heal your spirit man. And because you are offended at me, you still, I can heal your broken bones. But then you want to open up and let me heal your spirit man. Which suggests to me that teaching God's word is more mighty than healing your broken bones. The truth of Christ is more powerful and more meaningful to his creation than him healing your eyesight. My words, you wouldn't have listened. When we have teachable spirits, then the Lord can do mighty works within us. But if we do not have a teachable spirit and don't accept what the Bible says, then God cannot do mighty work. From when I look at this right here, healing a broken bone, that's elementary. Yeah, all right, it's elementary. A broken bone won't send you to hell. All right. But an unrepentant soul, spirit, will call you to go to hell.
Yeah, all right, Pastor.
So they were offended at the master. And when they became offended at him, then the block fell, his blessing from giving to them. Are they to come in? Boy, I just said something. We are hung up, and we are more concerned about the thing that you and I can see. But there are some unseen things that are more, that have more blessing than the seen thing. So this is what the Lord wants us to do. He wants us, amen, to be in a position that when his word come our way, that we accept his word. Now, you look at everything and all this stuff that's going on now, I'm afraid that there are some people that's really not accepting what God has to say. You cannot accept. I didn't just say here. I said accept what God said. If you accept God's word, then there is no way that you would do all these other things if you accept his word.
That's right.
Now, if you're doing everything else, you might know his word. But I'm talking about accept his word and live by his word. You come from the same home corner I came from. Where was it that What have I got you? Yeah, you right. I came from the same hometown you came from. But what has that got to do with my spiritual walk with the Lord? It's not my goal. Because you still crippled and hopping because you will not accept and live by the word of God. You dealing with hometown memories. Folk get in folk business and don't know what you're talking about. Honey, I remember. That's what they said. I don't know anything about it, but that's what they said. They said, I remember this, young. And I remember, I can't get rid of it. They said that that's not his mama, that's not his dad. They said, hometown memory. Well, they didn't have no DNA back then, no way. Can I just go and teach? Talking about what you remember. Then you got to remember somebody remember something on you. Can I get an amen? I have to ask amen tonight. All in the comments. Go ahead, preacher.
Okay. I was sitting there and I was listening. All these people kept getting up and talking about what they remembered about Anthony.
Mm-hmm.
And my uncle this, and my uncle could cook, and my uncle. Mm-hmm. Not one person did say he had become a man of God.
Yeah.
But nobody mentioned seeing him again. Nobody mentioned where he was gone. It's just, we're going to miss you, because I remember what, you know, they remembered him when he was young, or they remembered him. They had nothing to do, and I wanted to get up and say, well, won't we see him again or something? But when I was listening, when you were talking, I was just listening about people go back, and all they can remember is what you did when you was running around.
Mm-hmm.
I remember when beat me up, and I remember Arthur Lee would do this, and I remember Arthur Lee would do that, and I'm going, where is Arthur Lee now? Arthur Lee laying there saying, talk to the hangman. that's what I was. Now I'm with the Lord. Mm-hmm. Talk to the hangman. I was thinking the same thing you're talking about. All they can do was think about the memory. But you got to remember, where just like in this story, in this passage, they have to remember God, but God, you know, and don't be hung up on what they used to do. Think about what they're doing now. Like you say, that whatever killed him was not going to send him to heaven or hell.
You know,
physical body.
Okay, and you know, when we first got started, we talked about hometown memory.
Mm-hmm.
Some of them are good,
mm-hmm.
and then some of them are not worth a cent.
Yeah.
And then the thing about them is, sometimes we as people, we don't know when to share mm-hmm. and how to share mm-hmm. memory
mm-hmm.
and what time to share mm-hmm. memory. I was at a wake not too long ago, and they getting up, you know, and and I was presiding over the way. I had to set the guy down because they had listened. He got up there and started talking about, he went way back. Started telling everything to him and the guy, you know. And the thing about it, folks don't want to hear all that stuff. They don't know anything about him back then. But but you still living back there. And you just, the only thing you can think about is what they did. Then I see your hand go.
Oh, no, I just said a lot of times. We can always remember the bad, but we never want to realize this person can change. We never realize that anybody can change from it. Because when I say here, we always talk about, well, when he did this, it is usually the thing that's questionable, you know, the thing that's bad. But it never gets to the point where way before he passed, he made a 360 as far as his life can change. But everybody don't want to say anything about it.
Most time people don't they remember when you fell down. And they'll still talk about when you fell. But then they got words, or they saw you when you got up, and they don't talk about that. They won't talk about when they saw you when you fell down. But listen, in verse number 5, what did it look like? The reason why they arrived. They got to this point right here. It looked like to me that his disciples were dealing, not his disciples, but the people there in Nazareth, looked like to me that they were dealing with a lack of faith. Reason why his mighty word was limited.
Yeah.
His mighty word, the Lord's word, was limited. And the reason why his voice was limited to his hometown, it was because of a lack of faith. They remembered him, and because they remembered him, he's a homeboy, they didn't have faith in him. Their remembrance of him as a homeboy robbed them of their faith in the Lord. You don't need to, don't let the memory rob you of your faith. His weight was limited. He said, now listen, only thing, it says right there, only thing that he was able to do was lay his hand on heal them. That's the only thing he was able to do.
Yeah.
But then he said that, and he could there do no, it said there, specified the place, in Nazareth. He could there do no mighty works, except that he laid his hand upon a few sick folks and healed them. Listen, it's sad to do the Lord like this. Now he done come all the way from heaven, come here to save man from their sin and prepare them for heaven. And you going to put him in a position where that he can't do nothing but heal a broken bone of yours. Like a faith. So that lets me know that out of all of the work we do, teaching the truth, the word of God, is a mightier work than anything else that we can do. It says it right there in Scripture. Because their lack of unbelief, their lack of faith, his word was not able to connect with their soul. Because they remembered him as a hometown boy. Playing with captives. Out of the comments. Yes, sir.
Many times people that I didn't see not strong in the belief or strong followers of Christ, or you know, unbelievers, a lot of times they try to diminish the Lord because of their unbelief. Because they'll say, why am I still in this situation? If God is this and that, they expect for God to do things for them or to help them turn their life around, but they don't believe it. But yet they feel because he's God anyway, he's supposed to do things with me, and they forget, you know, one of the main ingredients, faith and belief.
As powerful as God is, he will not force himself upon us. Now, he will not force a change. Now, he has the power to force a change. But the primary change in a person's life is not because God forced him. He didn't come here to force us. But now, there was one, couple, two or three, that I can recall, that he just arbitrarily saved them. Because he saw the work that was in them while they was working and operating on the other side of the fence. Right. So he just said, let me go, Paul, let me go and say you. Let me just say you. You on your way to kill somebody.
Yeah.
And the Lord just saved them.
Yeah.
But we as people, we lock the Lord out. We lock our blessing out. And when it comes down to teaching God's word, that is one of the greatest work that people can do. You teach God's word. You teach it, then you turn around. You need to live. Amen.
Amen.
The Bible said, verse number 6. And he marveled because of their what? He marveled because of their unbelief. Thought about it. What about them? Y'all still holding on to this? And he went round about the village teaching. When they would not allow him to make connection with them, he marveled. I don't know what he said, but the scripture said he left their presence and went round the village teaching. And no doubt there was somebody that would accept. But no doubt the religious leader, it was a religious leader that would not accept, you know, what was going on. And that said to me, listen, the Lord himself, he can t- time to kind of force stuff up on us. Amen. He said that his spirit would not dwell with all the children of Israel in the book of Joshua. He said, now listen, because of y'all sin, I'll tell you what I'm going to do. I'm going to go back to my place. Otherwise, I'm going to go home. He's like, now listen, until y'all get it together, until y'all, you know, until you repent, you can't ask me for anything. I still love you.
Yeah.
But you can't ask me for no faith. He went to his faith. And you don't want to force God to go home on you. You might need something while he's gone. So he left that present and went around teaching. And listen, the Bible teaches us that one man planted, another man watered. But God is the one that gives the increase. Let us not be like Jesus' hometown people, hanging on to stuff that we should have turned loose a long time ago. Because it is hometown memory that sometimes slow us down. It called these people here, put them in a position where the Lord was not able to do a mighty work on them. Only thing he's able to do, heal the broken arm, gave sight to the blind, able them to walk, but then he couldn't reach their heart. They had a broken heel arm, heel legs, no doubt good eyesight, going into hell. But I would rather, watch this now, I would rather go to heaven with a broken arm, blinded eye, one leg, I would rather go to heaven. Because the scripture says, when it's all over, down here, when you see me again, that broken arm, it won't be the same. Whatever the songwriter says, whatever is broken. Anybody believe that? Whatever is broken, he can fix it. And it's a good thing to know the truth of Jesus Christ. A lot of times we be operating and we think we are doing the right thing, and we be doing just the opposite, doing that thing which is wrong. All right, that's it for tonight. Let us all stand.